I hope you came with your shouting shoes on. Hallelujah. Oh, I came to Jesus as I was. Oh, Lord.
Weary, worn, and sad.
Said I found.
Found in him.
Rest.
Rest in place.
He healed.
Healed and made me glad.
Ooh. Oh, must Jesus bear this cross of love.
If you're a little wounded, you ought to come to Jesus.
I came to Jesus.
Oh, Lord, somebody got the Holy Ghost, say ya.
Somebody got the Holy Ghost.
Did you get that power? Make you love your enemy. Treat your neighbor right.
Somebody got
that power. Got all in my hand. I got all in my feet. Change my talk.
Something waiting on you on the other side. He got a crown of life waiting on you. Everybody say welcome.
Welcome.
Come on and say welcome.
Welcome.
I'm getting my house in on Tuesday.
Welcome, my.
I've been faithful over a few things.
Welcome, my good and faithful sir.
When they call my name for eternal life,
I welcome.
Said I'll take my flight. So many don't believe that he's coming back. If you don't believe nothing, you can believe that. Said I'm waiting on Jesus to shake my hand. I'm waiting on Jesus. With him I will stand. I say give me my robe, dress it down in white. I say give me my robe, might come and get me tonight. He'll welcome me.
You want to hear him say, welcome.
Welcome.
I'm getting my house in on today.
Welcome, my.
You've been faithful on a few things.
Welcome, my good and faithful sir.
When they call your name,
welcome
will you be ready?
Welcome
will you be ready?
Welcome
he'll welcome me.
He'll welcome me.
He'll welcome me.
He'll welcome me.
Get my house in order.
He'll welcome me.
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 I can't wait, Bishop.
He'll welcome me.
I can't wait, Chief.
He'll welcome
me. To get over there.
He'll welcome
where
me.
My Jesus is.
He'll welcome
I got a testimony.
He'll welcome
I got a testimony.
He'll welcome
that your angels can't sing. Said I made it over. Said I made it over. By my testimony and the blood of the Lamb.
Hello, I'm Pastor Earl Jones with Refuge Temple Ministries here in Humble, Texas. Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 10, "There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you're able, but will with the temptation also make a way of escape, that ye may be able to bear it." Growing up in a Christian home, how do you navigate through the manifold temptations of high school? In this episode of Young and Saved, we'll hear how one young lady responded to this challenge. Now, please welcome Sherilyn Wilson.
Hello, my name is Sister Sherilyn Wilson. I am a member of the RTM Lake Charles, Louisiana location. My mother is Sister Dorothy Julian. My mom received the Holy Ghost and joined the ministry back in 1981. At that time, I was 2 years old. And I remember just, we was at church every single day. We were at church from Sunday morning early, Sunday school. We was Sunday morning church service. Then we would be back for Sunday night service. We had Bible studies. There were meetings. We had church service on Friday nights. My mom was actually a part of the choir. And so we had choir rehearsal on Thursdays. And during that time, there were so many different singing groups within the ministry. My mom was a part of a couple of those singing groups as well. So we had rehearsal at church during that time. And if there wasn't rehearsal at the church, we were at one of the singers' houses, and she was having rehearsal during that time as well. And sometimes on Friday nights, it wasn't just a regular church service. There was also a fast and a shut-in. And when we had our fast and shut-in, we actually stayed the night. So we was actually at church, you could say, on Saturdays as well. And I can remember on during the summer months, we had our annual week-long vacation Bible school, which was such a fun time for me. And I could just remember just growing up in a ministry, how I would just love the music that I was hearing. The songs that was being sung and just the praise and worship. And I can remember just sitting in my seat, just as a little girl, just being so amazed at how people was praising God and just how they were just enjoying Jesus. And I remember my mom would give me my little change and my little coins to go put it in the offering. And so when we would go up to the offering to put the change in the offering basket, I would praise God as I'm walking up to the offering basket, and I would wait until I put my little change in the basket so I can hear my little coins just click at the bottom. And then I would praise God as I'm walking back to my seat and bucking, just mimicking what I saw the older saints in the church doing. And when the choir would sing, I would go in my mom's purse and get a hairbrush or a pen or anything I can find. And I would stand up in the aisle. And as the singer is singing, I'm mimicking what I see them doing. I'm like mouthing the word that they're saying, because I'm like imagining myself up there singing as well. So my whole life was just church. That's all we done. That's all we did. That's all that I knew. So all of my friends just growing up in church, all my friends were the members from the church. And so even in school, we all went to the same school. And the same messages and the things that I was learning doing services, doing Sunday school, my mom made sure that she instilled that in me, even being at home. I remember her buying me a little children's Bible, and we would go through the stories in the Bible, and then she would ask me questions about it. What did this mean? And what does that mean? And what God says about this? And as I began to get older, when they would fast, she would also put me on a fast. And I wouldn't go the whole day, but she would put me maybe like a couple of hours here where I'm not watching cartoons, but I'm actually praying along with her. And so that done something for me as just being a little kid, because I wanted to be that. I wanted to be just like my mom. I didn't see a time where she was sad or she was depressed on what she was doing. But it, she just was so happy in just praising God and just the things that she was doing within the ministry. And so I remember going through middle school. It wasn't really a hard time for me doing, elementary school. It wasn't really a hard time because I had my friends from the church. And so those were the ones that I gravitated to and I connected with. I did notice, you know, a difference as far as we was wearing skirts and dresses and stuff, and all the other girls at school was wearing pants. And they were, of course, celebrating holidays and everything. But those things, it didn't faze me. It didn't matter to me. It wasn't something that I was like, well, Mom, why are we doing it? At that time, it wasn't something that I was just worried about. And so when I was going into middle school, when I had turned 12, my mom had told me, she said, hey, Sherlyn, she said, I was asked for my hand in marriage. And she said, from one of the brothers from the New Orleans location, because we had a refuge temple in New Orleans, Louisiana at that time. And she said, and I said, yes, so I'm going to be marrying this brother, and we're going to be moving from Lake Charles to New Orleans, Louisiana. I wasn't really happy about it at first, because in my mind, I'm like, I'm leaving everything that I know. I don't even know anything about New Orleans, and I'm leaving all of my friends that are here in the ministry here, and now I'm moving to another city that I'm not even familiar with. But got over it, and then the summer of my when I turned 12, that summer, we ended up moving to New Orleans, Louisiana. And when we moved there, the church home at that time, it was the same preaching, the same word, the same services, everything that we was getting fed here at the Lake Charles location was also the same words and teachings and stuff that was going on in the New Orleans location. And before I was getting ready to start my eighth grade year, I remember hearing about how the Holy Ghost was just falling on the youth at the Lake Charles location. And because I still had friends, and we would still talk on the phone every now and then, and we would still travel from New Orleans to Lake Charles to some of the services, and I still had family there. So I would hear about how the Holy Ghost was just falling and the youth was just so excited. It was on fire for God. And these were all my friends that I grew up with. And so I wanted that same Holy Ghost that they had. I wanted that same happiness and that same joy that they had. And of course, like I said before, church was all that I knew. So that's the only life that I knew of. That one particular weekend, the ministry-wide had planned a youth revival. And so the youth revival was going to be held in New Orleans, Louisiana. So I remember that Friday during the day, we had a lot of youth that came in from Lake Charles and I believe Lafayette, and some of them stayed at our home in New Orleans. And so we got ready for church, and as we was getting ready, the ones that stayed at our house from Lake Charles was some of the friends that I was with when I was living there. And so they were just telling me about how they felt when they received the Holy Ghost, and it just kind of provoked like a godly jealousy in me. It's like I wanted to have what my friends had. And so that Friday night, we get to church, and the song service was good. And there was one of the youth from the Lake Charles ministry that was going to be opening up with the preaching for that particular night. So the word began to come forth, and then after the word was ministered, they had an altar call. And a lot of youth went up to the altar to get saved. I went up there, but that night I did not get it. And I just remember just feeling just so discouraged and so hurt because all of my friends around me, you know, they were getting saved, you know, and just I remember just, you know, how they was telling me how they was feeling after they received the Holy Ghost, but I did not get it. So when I went home, I began to just tell my mom, you know, how I was feeling or whatever. And then she was just ministering to me and everything and just telling me how when I go up there or whatever, I need to make sure that I'm not going up there just because they going up there, but I'm going up there because this is what I really want God to do for me. I really want this. And so that Saturday during the day, I made up in my mind. I said, okay, Saturday, today, I'm going to get it. I'm going to get this Holy Ghost. And so Saturday, we go to service and we go through the praise and the worship service. And then that Saturday, so they called a second person, a second youth to go up there and to do the preaching that particular night. And so before the young guy began to open up with his message, he had a question. And his question was, he said, if you was to leave out of this building today, he said, and you was to die, where do you think you will go? And it's like when he began to ask that question, it's like I'm thinking, I'm just reflecting like, okay, God, I don't want to die. God, if I leave out of this building and if something happens to me and I was to die, I know where I'm going because I'm not even saved. And so the whole time he preaching, I'm in my mind, I'm like, God, just save me. God, I don't want to be the same way. God, I want the Holy Ghost. God, you got to save me. God, I want to be changed. I want to be free. And so I'm just saying all that in my mind. And so at the end of the preaching, they began to call an altar call. So I immediately ran up there. This time I said I wasn't going to walk. I was going to run. So I immediately went up to the altar and they began to just come pray for me. And all of a sudden the Holy Ghost just began to fall on me. And so I remember just after that, I was just feeling so excited. I'm happy now. I'm saved. I got the Holy Ghost. I got the Holy Ghost, but now, you know, what do I do with it is what I'm saying in my mind. Like, what do I do with it now? Where do I go from here? So I remember starting my eighth grade year. And like I said, when I moved to New Orleans, you know, I don't know anybody there. And so I go to this middle school and none of the Saints children from the New Orleans location was at this school. So I'm here in this school, don't know nobody. Trying to find friends and trying to find someone that I could maybe relate to or someone that's maybe like me, have you know, Christian family, Christian values, but could not find that. So I felt so alone. I just felt like just all by myself. And so now I'm starting to not looking just for a friend that's just like me. So now I'm trying to be like what I see. The kids in the school started listening to different type of R&B music. So now I'm finding myself like on the school buses, I'm bobbing my head to what I'm listening to. And now I'm starting to see how, now hear different conversations of the girls. Now they're talking about what cute guy they like. And so now that's interesting to me. Now I really want to know exactly, you know, what it is that they're talking about. And now I'm trying to get in the mix of that conversation. So of course now I have no power. I have no Holy Ghost that's keeping me. And so I go into my freshman year. This is a whole nother school. Now this is a bigger school. This is high school. Still in New Orleans. Still don't know nobody. Still no Saints children from the other New Orleans that's in this same school. This is just me now. I'm in this high school. So now it's more temptations, more things that I'm noticing. Now I'm noticing that there are girls my age. They have boyfriends now. They are dancing now. And so it's just those things. Now I'm curious, like, man, they look like they having fun. But in our house, all we doing is go to church. And so now I'm trying to find that friend that I can gravitate to, but I'm not finding one that's like me. So now I'm trying to be like them and not fitting in. And so the end of my freshman year, my parents come and they tell us, they say, the church in New Orleans is going to be transitioning to the RTM Houston location. So we will be moving. So We did. The summer ending my freshman year, we ended up moving to Houston, where we was added to the RTM Houston location. So now I'm in a whole new state, a whole new city again, a whole new crop of people. So I'm trying to learn who I am at this point. I'm trying to learn what it is that just trying to learn myself. And so I start this new school my sophomore year. There's no Saints again children that is attending this school. So now I'm in this school, and I am still searching for a friend, still trying to find someone that I could relate to, or someone that I can gravitate to, someone that's just like me. And so now I'm noticing more. I'm noticing now people are going to homecoming dances. There's football games. There's cheerleaders. There's all kind of different activities that is going on in within the school. Now there's more girls that are talking about their boyfriends. They're talking about different movies that they have watched. Now it's more music. Now they're talking about rap. I mean, I'm just seeing all of these things. I'm listening to it, and now it's becoming interesting to me. Now I want to know what it is that they're experiencing. I want to see those things. And so as I'm going through my sophomore year, now my attitude and the things about me is now starting to change. That little girl that was once just so excited about church when her parents bring her there, now my mom and my dad at that time, they had put us in the youth choir when we got to Houston. So we was a part of the youth choir. We was going to all the services, and of course we was going to the fast and shut-ins. But now it was different for me now. I wasn't enjoying going to service. It's like, God, we gotta go to service every single time, or I'm tired of going to choir or whatever. And it just felt like it was a punishment. And so as I'm going through my sophomore year and part of my junior year, just trying to just find me, trying to find myself. I'm still feeling empty. I'm just still feeling just lost. And so I recall a time where at this particular time now, me and my mom is kind of like not really butting heads, but it's like everything that she's doing now is just starting to aggravate me. Like by her, she asking me how my day was at school, just how, you know, how's my life. And now she's, you know, talking about God and me getting, you know, back in church the way how I need to be, and just things like that. It's like now it's starting to aggravate me. Now I don't even, you know, it's like I'm not getting a hate for her, but now she's starting to get on my nerves. And so I recall one time I was in a room and I wasn't really doing anything important. But I was just sitting around on the bed, just messing with some things. And in the home, in our house, we each had, each of the children each had a week of time that we had to do the kitchen. So this particular time was my week to do the dishes. And so my mom came in there and she said, Sherlyn, this is your week. Make sure you go in there and you get those dishes and stuff together. She said, but make sure you don't do it late, because your dad and we're going to bed at a certain time and we don't want to hear, you know, the dishes, you washing dishes and stuff while we're trying to rest. So I said, okay, I'm gonna get them. And so she kind of like just looked at me and then she had walked out. And then maybe like about an hour or so later, she came back in and she said, Sherlyn, she said, you still have not moved to go get those, to go wash those dishes. She said, I need you to make sure you get them dishes done before me and your dad get ready for bed. So I looked at her again and I said, okay, I'm getting them done. But in my mind, I was saying, please leave me alone and get out of here. And so when she walked out of the room, I immediately got up and I went to the restroom and I began to close the door. And while I was in the restroom, I was looking in the mirror as if I was looking at her. And everything that I was thinking, I was just saying it out. And I was just saying it out to what I was seeing in the mirror. And as I began to stop and I really looked at what I was seeing in the mirror, it wasn't me that I was looking at. It was a totally different person. It was like this this little girl who was just loving church and everything so much, is like my inside was just so ugly. But what I saw, it scared me. And so that was a turning point in my life that said, I need to change. This that I'm feeling on the inside, I need to change, because it's like now I'm starting to blame my mom to why I didn't have any friends, why I felt lonely. Because you brought, you know, I felt like she brought me to these places, and then I could not make friends. And so I remember when I was 17, they had we had church service that Friday night, and then that Sunday morning, we had church service. Pastor Jimmy was preaching, and they called an altar call, and I went up there, and then God filled me with the Holy Ghost. So I remember being filled with the Holy Ghost at 17. I felt like, okay, I'm gonna do everything that I know. I need to do everything that I was taught, everything that I saw my mom do. You know, I know I could keep this. I know I could stay safe. So going through my senior year was good, and I found myself at that time, I was getting more dedicated to God. I transitioned from the youth choir to the adult choir. We had a women's, like a little group, a little singing group in the Houston church, and I became a part of that. I was at the Bible studies. I was at all of the church services. I was getting in my word. I was praying. I was doing those things that I knew that I needed to do that was going to keep me right. And so now I'm going into my freshman year in college, and I'm still saved, still got the Holy Ghost, and I'm still praying, still doing what I need to do. So I'm going into my freshman year, and still at this time, we were still traveling from, Houston to Lake Charles and over to have the fifth Saturday services and any of the revivals. My biological father actually was living in Lake Charles at that time. So I would actually travel on some weekends to go see him. Well, doing all this traveling and things like that, I started taking a liking to one of the young brothers from the Lake Charles Church. And at first it was very innocent, started off as just friends and just saying, hi, how you doing? And we wasn't even talking on the phone at that time. When I would see him or we would meet up, it was with a group of other saints from the church, but we were never alone. So it just started off just innocent, just us, just friends. But it's like whenever I would find myself leaving from his presence, now I'm starting to think about him. Like, now I'm wondering, what is he doing? Now I kind of want to talk to him on the phone. I done saw him already. We done said hi, but now I want to talk to him on the phone. In the midst of traveling back and forth, like I said, to the services and things like that, now we are exchanging numbers. So now we are talking on the telephone, and it started off as just maybe a little conversation, then we hang up. Now it's talking constantly. Now it's talking every single day. He had told me that he was going to be leaving the college that he was at. He was going to be relocating to transfer to McNeese in Lake Charles, and he was going to be moving back to his parents' home. So I talked to my mom and my dad, and I asked them, I said, hey, is it okay if I move to Lake Charles and go to McNeese, and that way I can get, I can be with my biological father, and I'll be close to the ministry there, working, you know, the ministry with my friends and things like that. And at that time, when I was going to the university in Texas, it was hard for me. So I was like, you know, I think McNeese may be a little easier for me because it's a smaller college, and this, that, and the other. And so, they thought about it for a while, and then they agreed to let me move back to Lake Charles. So when I moved back to Lake Charles, I got involved in the youth choir there, and I was attending the services, but I wasn't doing what I needed to do. I was only attending those services and being a part of that choir because the guy that I was interested in, I wanted to be closer to him. I wanted to have more time to spend with him. And in my mind, I was like, well, you know, it'll be okay because we're both saved, you know, just like the Bible talking about taking fire in your bosom. And I felt like, you know, we're both saved. We know our boundaries. We know how far to go and where not to take this. And so I felt like it would be okay, like this is something that I could handle. Now I'm in Lake Charles, and I don't have a car at that time, but he has a car. So I'm asking him to pick me up to, let's go to rehearsal together, or pick me up, let's go to church service together, or can you pick me up so I can go to Bible study? But I'm making every excuse I can think of to get him to come pick me up, and I'm just being in his presence. And so now that little innocent little thing that was going on now is much more. Now is like I'm being I'm consumed now with just really him, just wanting to be in his presence, want to hear his voice. Now this is all about him. So my prayer life is just dwindling down. I'm not praying the way I should. I'm not really partaking in any of the youth teachings and youth nights and stuff that they have going on. I'm not really partaking in that anymore. I am not fasting the way how I should. I'm not even getting in my word anymore. Now it's just all about him. When I was in school going to McNeese, now I'm doing bad. I'm like about to lose my financial aid because I'm not even focused on school. Now it got to the point to where I would say I'm going to class, but I'm actually going to hang out with him. We're going to see a movie or something. And so now it's like he became my life. He became my world. And so now we're still thinking that we can just hold on. We can just still hold on to each other and still just be, you know, just still be saved. We were just slowly just being sifted. And it happens. We fornicated and failed. And so I just remember when it happened, I felt so bad. I just felt so dirty. Like, I can't believe I let this happen. You know, I was a virgin, and I always told myself that I was going to save myself a marriage. That's what my mom taught me. That's what the word taught me. I was not going to do these things. I was not going to be the type of girl that I saw growing up in school. Or, like, you know, I had cousins that had babies, you know, and with people they wasn't even married to. And I said, this was not going to happen to me. But this happened. And I just remember just feeling so shame, like, oh my God, I can't believe, you know, I have done this. And this wasn't just with anybody, but this was somebody from the church, you know, someone that was well respected, you know. Now, you know, we have done this. And so backslid. And even though I was feeling it hurt and feeling condemned, it didn't stop me. I still wanted it. It still felt good to me just to be in his presence, just to be with him. And so now we're going through life now as boyfriend and girlfriend. And at that time, I didn't want to continue living in my dad's home being like this, because my dad was in church. He had got ordained as a minister, and I just felt so dirty. I didn't even want to be in his home, just being in that type of condition and type of way. So I ended up moving out, and I ended up staying with my aunt. And even staying with my aunt, I felt like that just wasn't enough for me to even be with my boyfriend. He, like I said, he was my world. He consumed me. And so I didn't want to just be with my boyfriend. I mean, be at my aunt's house. I wanted us to be in the same home. So we ended up living together, getting an apartment together, and trying to figure out what this boyfriend and girlfriend thing was, because neither one of us has, we wasn't raised like that. And this was something that we didn't even know. This world wasn't anything that we didn't know how to conduct ourselves like that. And I can remember one time we called ourselves trying to celebrate Christmas. We ended up buying some Christmas trees, and we put up some lights and put up some ornaments and even wrapped some Christmas presents. And after it was all said and done, we looked at each other like, okay, so what do we do now? I mean, how you feel about it? How you feel about it? So as we begin to just go on in this relationship, I found out that I was pregnant. So I had found out maybe like a couple of weeks, and then I didn't tell him until later because I just didn't know how to tell him. And so when I told him I was pregnant, we both was heartbroken. I didn't know how I was going to tell my parents, and I definitely did not know how I was going to tell his parents. So we finally went ahead and needed to make sure that we let them know. So we told his parents, and his parents, of course, they were hurt. But they instructed us, and I began to tell my parents, and they was hurt as well. And I can remember, as even though we was living like this and we was going on in this this sinful life that we was living, we never stopped going to the church services. When there was New Year's Eve services, we was going. When there was a camp meeting, we was still going. Even though we was living this life, we still knew that there was a God, and we was still going to church. And so now I'm pregnant. Now I'm big and pregnant. And so we're going through, the motions and everything. And, now it's come time for me to have the baby. So I had the baby, and after I had my child, I noticed that my, boyfriend started acting different with me. He wasn't being touchy-feely with me anymore. He would call me to check on the child, but it wasn't about, hey, I miss you, or you want to get together, or you want me to come and we have lunch or something together. It wasn't about me and him, but it was only about the child. And so we would still ride to church services together, but he would sit in another area of the church. He wouldn't sit by me. And it wasn't like after church service, we're going to go out to eat. No, he would bring me back to to where I was staying. And then he would leave. And he would call and said, hey, I'm coming to get the baby, have the baby ready. And he would meet me at the door. He wouldn't even come in the house, but he would meet me at the door, take the child and the child things. So he was changing, and it was scaring me, because I felt like I'm about to lose him. And so we had a conversation about, you know, this difference that I was starting to see in him. And that's when he began to tell me that he was seeking God. He wanted to be saved. He didn't want to be in this relationship like this anymore. He wanted to raise his son up in holiness. And so at that time, it's like, yeah, okay, I know you want to be saved, but what about us? I mean, I came down here for you. Now we have this child together. I mean, we need to just get married or whatever. And it's like all kind of things was just going in my mind. Now he's about to leave me. If he gets saved, he is not going to marry me. He's not going to want to be with me, because the Bible talk about being unevenly yoked. So he's not going to want me anymore if he gets saved. I'm telling him, I say, well, you know what? I'm just going to move to Houston. Me and my child, we're just going to move back to Houston. I'm going to just go stay with my parents. And so in the midst, after I had told him that, so now I'm trying to prepare myself to move. Coming down to Houston, looking at different apartments. I have a cousin that actually stays in Houston. So I'm communicating with her and her husband and asking her, you know, if she mind me and my child come and live with her for a little while. So I'm making preparations to get myself in Houston, because I figured I just need to just get out of his way. And so while in the midst of me doing that, it's like every door was just closing. My cousins decided, no, you can't come stay with us. I couldn't even find a good job that was even going to pay, help me, that was going to give me the amount of money I needed to pay for rent. So about a week or so later, I called them and I said, well, me and your son is not going to leave. We're not going to move. We're just going to stay here. But I say, you know, well, I mean, you go ahead on. If that's what you want to do, that's what you want to do. But I'm not ready. And so that was the end of that conversation. And so I guess, too, also in my mind, I felt that if I told him I was leaving, then he would, you know, change his mind about him wanting to change him, about him wanting to be saved if I told him that I was leaving. But it did not. Now I'm still here in Lake Charles. He's still seeking to be saved. You know, we are doing this co-parenting thing now. And so now we're coming up to the annual camp meeting. And like I said, even though we was living like this, we didn't miss church service for nothing. And so we getting ready for, the church was getting ready for the camp meeting back in 2002. And so that Sunday before the camp meeting, I remember sitting in service and, you know, songs being sung, praise and worship going on the choir, and then a preacher began to come up and he began to minister. And as I'm sitting in service in this building, I experienced something that I haven't before. You would hear how people say whenever the word coming forth, it seems as if the preacher is talking directly to you. Well, I felt that, but I also, in my mind, it was like I was the only person sitting in the building. And for a couple of times, I had looked around just to make sure that the person that was sitting next to me was still there. Because for a moment, it felt like I was the only one sitting in the building. And the preacher was pointing and he was talking directly to me. So as the word coming forth or whatever, and the preacher, he began to say how don't feel like that God can't reach down and he can't grab you out of that situation that you're in. And he was just saying how don't feel like that you have done so much that God can't save you, and how you need to return to back to your first love. And the word was just, it was just pricking my heart. And so the whole time I'm sitting there, I'm listening and I'm taking it all in. They had an altar call. I did not move. And so we go through the weekend, the Tuesday night of the first night of the camp meeting start. And so getting ready for camp meeting, got to camp meeting, service, awesome. Preacher began to come up and preach the word of God. And he's preaching and it's like all of a sudden now is like I'm getting teary-eyed. I'm getting emotional. And he just, and it's like those things that I was dealing with on the inside, he was preaching it across the pulpit. They called an altar call. I still did not move. And so that Wednesday night came, same thing, awesome praise and worship. The preacher began to get up there. He began to preach the word of God and more tears coming. Now at this particular moment, now I'm rocking in my seat. Because I just can't sit still. And so I'm rocking in my seat and then I grab my child and I'm rocking him as well. And they call an altar call. I still did not get up and move. This particular Thursday, as I was getting ready, normally my son, you know, he's 6 months old now. And usually whenever I'm getting him prepared to go somewhere or getting him dressed, he may vomit on himself or just be all fussy and everything to where, it would cause me to be late to try to get where I'm trying to go. He wouldn't be cooperative. But this particular Thursday, he was just so sweet. I got him dressed and he ended up falling asleep and I woke him up, fed him a bottle, and he was just so good. I didn't have no troubles with getting him to service. And so we got to service and like I said, me and my child's father, we rode together that night and he actually sat closer towards the front, and I sat closer towards the back like I normally do. And so I'm sitting there in service, and the service, even the prayer, from the prayer on, it's like when they begin to open up with the prayer, it's like something was going on with me. I knew in my mind what it was, but I was just trying to just get it to the back of my head. But God was really dealing with me, even during the prayer. So as we as the prayer began to end or whatever, and they started going into the praise and worship, God was really doing something for me. I literally felt like how the that children's story when they talk about Humpty Dumpty when he fell off that wall and how he just shattered. Even in that Thursday night service, I just began to feel like I was shattered, but God was putting those pieces back together. So every song that they sung, even if it was an old song that they sung when I was 2 years old, it still does something for me. And it's like every testimony that I was hearing, God was just putting pieces back together. And so as I'm sitting in service and the preaching began to preach, I'm sitting in service and I'm crying at this moment. My face is just full of tears because I'm crying, because now I'm like, God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for ever leaving you. I'm sorry for even going into this lifestyle that I knew that was totally wrong. And so they began to call the altar call, and it literally felt like someone just came and just grabbed my hand and walked me up there. But it was nobody to grab my hand, but I know it was just like somebody just grabbed my hand and just walked me up to the altar. And so as I'm going up to the altar, I feel somebody grab my child. So I'm going up to the altar and I'm crying out to God. I'm telling God, God, I repent, God. God, I'll give up all of these ways. God, I'll give up my child's father. God, I don't want that relationship. God, whatever it takes, God, if I got to raise this child all by myself, God, then so be it, God. I just want it, God. I just wanted to be saved. I didn't want to still feel the same hurt, this same loneliness. I just wanted God. I wanted God to fill that void and the emptiness that I had on the inside of my life. And as I began to do all things, it's like the Holy Ghost just began to fall upon me. And when it fell upon me, I kind of like just kind of stumbled down to my knees because I just felt so light. I just felt like a feather. All of that hurt and that loneliness and the stuff that I was carrying and all that depression and just embarrassment that I was just holding on to. I was just feeling so light and just so free. And I just remember just leaving from the service just feeling so good on the inside. And even then, after that time, is my child's father, he had got saved that following night. And even though, you know, we were saved, we didn't say, okay, this is the good opportunity for us to get together and go home ahead and get married. No, we made sure that God cleaned us up the way how we needed to be clean. And so I'm going through the services. So now I'm, even though I have this child, I'm getting dedicated. I'm getting my dedication back. I got a part of the adult choir. I started making sure that I'm going to every single services. I'm staying connected to my leaders. I'm making sure that I stay in my word. At this time, it was all about God. I told God that I was going to do this thing the right way. And I was going to raise my child up the way how my parents had raised me up in holiness, knowing God. And so my child's father and I, we're going through the co-parenting thing, and you know, he's putting his hand to the plow, doing everything that he once was doing, fired up for God. And then further down during that year, we ended up getting married. My husband and I have now been married for a little over 19 years. We are both fully active in the ministry. My son, who we had before we were married, he will be 20 at the end of December. And he is our bass guitar player at the Lake Charles Church. We have a 17-year-old and our daughter who is also active in ministry. Since then, I have been ordained as a handmaiden. I am a co-director over fellowship and special events. I am on the adult praise team. I am in the choir. I am on the highways and hedges praise team. I assist with the youth choir. I am an assistant on the teaching team for the women's retreat, for the women's ministry. I also assist in teaching for the new members orientation, and I also assist with the teaching for the youth services. And I just thank God just for what God has been doing in our lives, and when we decided to do things the right way according to God's word, how he tremendously just blessed us. And I just want to encourage those parents who have youth from young up until teenage college years, get them in services, all of the youth teachings, the services that they're in. You know, the Bible says, train up your child in the way he should go, and as he's older, he will not depart. And I truly, truly, truly admonish you to make sure that your child is involved. Make sure that they are in these choirs, in the youth explosion. Don't let them just be sitting at home, just letting Facebook or Instagram or any of those things teach them the word. the world. You teach them what the Word of God says. And those youth who may be struggling with the temptations or the things that you are facing in this world, do not be afraid to ask somebody to help you or to get counsel. Seek out counsel. Don't feel like that you are in this alone. As long as you have God, you are not alone. You have someone walking with you. But you need to get connected. Get connected to your leaders. Talk to your parents about those things that you're feeling. This world has greater temptations that I have never experienced growing up. And you need your leaders. You need your parents. You know, and I just thank God because we have a church home here who we have, there's every aspect in our lives that we could gravitate to. And if you don't have a church home, please get with a ministry that is going to teach you the Word of God straight from the Bible. Get with a ministry that you see leaders and you see teachers, you see handmaidens, and you see people doing things according to what the Word says on how you need to be doing them. And before I end this this time, I want to go ahead on and end it with a word of prayer. God, I thank you, God, in this hour, Lord God, for all that you've done, God. God, I pray, God, in this hour, Lord God, the things, God, that I've spoken here, God, in this hour, Lord God, on today, God, be edifying, God, and begin to touch someone's life, God. Oh, God, use me, God, as your vessel, God, in this hour, Lord God. God, I pray, God, for the youth, God, of this world today, God, in this hour, Lord God, those that are lost, God, or those that are barely hanging on, God. God, I ask, God, that you move for them, God, in this hour, Lord God, that you begin to deal with their hearts, God, in their minds, God, in this hour, Lord God. God, let them know, God, that they don't have to be lost, God, they don't have to be the same, God, in this hour, Lord God. God, that they can come out, God, in this hour, Lord God, from where they are, God. God, I pray, God, even for the parents, God, in this hour, Lord God, that you give them strength, God. God, that you give them boldness, God, in this hour, Lord God, to have that standard in their homes, God, in this hour, Lord God. God, to teach, God, their children, God, in this hour, Lord God, the ways of you, God. God, that they, God, be examples, God, in this hour, Lord God, towards their children, God, in this hour, Lord God. God, that they continue, God, to raise them up, God, in you, God, in this hour, Lord God. Oh, God, we need you, God. This world needs you, God. Oh, God, and we ask all these things, God, in my name, Jesus, God. Amen.
Sherlyn learned the importance of valuing God's word over your feelings, thoughts, and relationships. David said it this way, I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. This broadcast was sponsored by Refuge Temple Ministries and funded by viewers like you. To help us, text RETMINC to the number 77977. Thank you for your support. To view other programs, go to our YouTube channel. And now you can also download the MyRTM app on your phone or tablet. I also recommend the new book, Determining Truth from Error, written by Apostle Wendell Archie. You can get your copy today from BarnesandNoble.com or Amazon.com. If you'd like to talk to one of our prayer counselors, you can call us toll-free at 1-866-480-1949 or 281-441-1031. Thank you for tuning in today, and may God richly bless you.
Just give your heart and your mind to Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh,
leave behind your regrets and stay.
Come today
and there's no
Jesus is calling. Bring on your sorrows,
bring
sorrows
and trade them for joy.
From the ashes, Jesus is calling. Oh, come on to the altar, the Father's arms, they're waiting on you. And if you need some forgiveness, if you need a change, it's right here.
Precious blood of Jesus.
Come on down to the altar. If you feel you've been too bad, God is able to redeem you. Hallelujah. And whatever you need, He's able. Yeah, yeah. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. So bow down before Him, for He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior, yes. You see, He sits on His throne in heaven, but yet He looks down to the one that can humble themselves and say, God, I need You. Even if you've been saved for a while, God is able to keep you and strengthen you. But you gotta bow down before Him. He's the Lord of all. And for that I say hallelujah. Oh,
come
to the altar. The Father's
arms.
Was bought with He purchased it with His blood.
Precious blood of Jesus.
Come on down. You don't have to wait till the altar call later on. But if you need God to do something for you, He can do it right now. Yes, He can. And forgiveness. If you need some power, the precious blood
of Jesus.
Come on down. To the
altar.
He's waiting on you. He's here. He's here to speak with you. Respond with the precious blood.
Oh,
God. God, we welcome You in. Yeah. Lord, we honor You. Really need You, Lord. We humble ourselves today, God. Yeah, yeah. So
come
to the altar. The Father's arms
are open.
Forgiveness was bought
with
the precious blood.